welcome those of you who are worshiping with us online and in our church at home, and thank you for sharing this time with us. Just a couple of announcements just to draw your attention to. Please remember there's going to be a sunrise service that will be online for you to use, posted on Saturday. And then if you or anyone you know is thinking of joining us next Sunday, Easter Sunday, we will begin at 10:30. So just make a note of that, 10:30. It's great to have you, and may God bless you this day. Second scripture is found in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 11. And I'll be reading the first 11 verses, and that is on page 823, 823 in the Pew Bible. Mark 11, beginning at verse 1. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you doing this?' say, 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here shortly.' They went and found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, "What are you doing untying that colt?" They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their when they brought their colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut in the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple courts. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. This is God's good news for us this day. Let's pray together. Father, I ask that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts would be acceptable and pleasing in your sight, O Lord, because you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So as we have heard, this is Palm Sunday, the last Sunday in Lent, as Lent ends next Saturday, just before Easter Sunday. And over these past 5 weeks, we've been seeing that following Jesus involves many different aspects. We've looked at baptism and temptation, suffering and salvation, worship and money, light and darkness, loss and gain. Today we will see that following Jesus also involves humility and strength. And so we ask ourselves the question, is humility a strength? Is humility a strength? Now most of us would probably be pretty quick to answer yes, humility is a strength. Although it may be hard to describe a humble person or define humility, we certainly know what an unhumble person looks like. And usually we don't like hanging around them too long. But sometimes it's still hard to define or explain true humility. Even our language today has been kind of mixed up about humility. About 5 years ago, Webster's added about 1,000 words to their online dictionary. And this was one of the words, humble brag. Humble brag. Anybody know what a humble brag is? Social media people? Well, it is sort of self-descriptive, but according to Webster's, a humble brag is to make a seemingly modest statement about yourself that is meant to draw attention to your amazing abilities. So here are two examples. And these are actually posted. People put this out there. So a person wrote on social media, "I just paid for someone's lunch at Wendy's. Enjoy your day." Or this one. "So, I legit only had $1 and no money, and I gave it to a homeless guy. Why am I so nice?" Humble brag. Pretty self-obvious.
Or be humble.
We'll get there. So see how confused our society is, right? People do something humble and kind, and then they draw attention to what they've done and brag about it. But the truth about humility is this. There's only one person who can't say you are humble. You. There's only one person who can't say I am humble. Me, right? And yet, consider these words of Jesus when he said, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." Jesus calls himself humble in heart. So, is Jesus doing a humble brag? Not quite. Jesus is offering people rest for their souls, a break from keeping all the rigid rules of religion that existed at the time. He's stating that, in fact, he is gentle. He is a humble, gentle teacher and savior compared to the religious teachers of his day. He's not wanting to burden our lives with man-made rules and laws or false guilt about never being good enough for God. However, Jesus does tell us in these words to come to him. He does tell us to yoke our life to him, to go side by side with him, to walk together with him. He does tell us to learn from him, to listen and follow him. But we do not do this as a burden. We don't do it out of guilt. We do it out of love. God loves us, and we seek to love God in return, a relationship. So Jesus is not telling us he is humble in heart just to show off, because he actually shows us his humility in the story that we just heard from the Gospels. We see that the people are gathered together and they're cheering for him, shouting, "Hosanna in the highest heaven." The word Hosanna basically means, "Lord, save us." People are expecting Jesus to come into Jerusalem, do amazing things, more miracles, to show that he is the king God has sent. This is why they say, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of David. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David." Sorry, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And blessed is he is the coming kingdom of our father David." Jesus could have worked the crowd. Jesus could have performed a miracle, drawn more attention. But he didn't. That wasn't his purpose. Jesus doesn't come riding on a horse, a military animal. Jesus comes on a donkey, a valuable but everyday working animal. People at the time rode donkeys, even important people. And yet, the donkey was not a symbol of war, but a symbol of peacetime. Jesus doesn't come like a conquering crusader king, arrogant and riding on a powerful horse. He doesn't come like the president of the United States traveling to other countries. Before the president arrives in most countries, a U.S. military cargo is sent ahead, a cargo plane is sent ahead, carrying all of the vehicles in his motorcade, or her motorcade, two armored vehicles for the president, sometimes a helicopter. That all goes before the president shows up. And then when the president, his bride is called the Beast, as you may know. And it's an armor-plated, bulletproof Cadillac, complete with reinforced tires and steel rims, so if the tires are shot out or destroyed, the car can keep moving. Not exactly a working donkey, right? So Jesus doesn't come as a powerful military leader. He doesn't come as a president of the world. He comes humble, riding on a donkey. But then is humility strength? Is humility strength? We've said yes, but is it good to be a humble leader? Do people willingly do what a humble leader tells them to do? Don't they just walk all over humble leaders? You know, we're all leaders in some form or another, whether it's with our children, with our grandchildren, in our home, with other people, on our job. We all have some kind of leadership role. And so we ask ourselves today, as we think about humility and strength, do people willingly do what I ask? Do my children or grandchildren gladly do what I ask? Does my spouse or partner willingly do what I ask? Or do people do what I ask just to appease me, to know that if they don't, I'm probably going to get angry? So we ask ourselves, do people willingly do what I ask out of love, out of relationship, or out of fear of saying no? Dr. Robert Hogan has a PhD in psychology and a former psychology professor at Johns Hopkins University. He founded Hogan's Assessments with his wife Joyce, also a doctor. And this company is the world leader in personality assessment and leadership development. They help many Fortune 500 companies, as well as companies all over the world, find good leaders, find good staff. Dr. Hogan has written an article entitled, Forget Charisma, Look for Humility in a Leader. Forget charisma, look for humility in a leader. As a world leader in personality and building successful companies, Dr. Hogan gives three characteristics of a humble leader. He says, self-awareness. Self-awareness. Humble leaders see themselves accurately and honestly, and they do this by listening to those around them who work for them and work with them. Second, they appreciate colleagues. Humble leaders appreciate the strengths and contributions of the people around them, knowing that the leader knows that he or she doesn't have all the strengths. And the third is that humble leaders are open to the ideas of others, new ideas coming from other people. And when I look at these three characteristics, I think this is exactly what Jesus does when he comes into our life, when he invites us to come and follow him. First, self-awareness. Jesus says, you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. When we come to Jesus, we look at the truth of ourselves, the good, bad, and the ugly, and he helps us to make us into the person God wants us to be, who God created us to be. Second, appreciate colleagues. Jesus says, love each other as I have loved you. When we love the people we work with, the people we serve with, the people in our church, the people in our community, when we love them, we will respect them and honor them. And finally, open to new ideas. Jesus said, and no one pours new wine into old wineskins. Otherwise, the wine will burst the skins, and both the wine and the wineskins will be ruined. No, they pour new wine into new wineskins. Humble leaders teach new ideas, but are open to new ideas coming from others. And whether it's in a business or in our church, we must stay relevant to the changing world. You know this. Or people forget us. Business passes us by. People pass us by in our church. So this is how Jesus lived his life, being self-aware that he was sent from God on a clear mission, appreciating and loving others. He gave his life for others. He was a humble servant leader who didn't come to build himself up, but in fact to bring others with him, to bring others into relationship with God. And then some people will say, yeah, but if you're humble, don't you lose your authority? But Jesus didn't lose his authority. In fact, this is what people said when they heard his teaching is, what is this? A new teaching and with authority. They recognized the authority of Jesus. This is why Jesus simply says to two disciples, he said, go into the city and give me a colt. And they do it. Why? Because he's their boss? Because they're afraid of him? No, because they have this relationship of trust with each other. And the people, when they hear, why are you taking this colt? They simply do what Jesus says. He has authority, but he has it because of his humility. Another way of saying it is that the strength of Jesus was his humility. And people followed him and did what he asked. One final point as we think about humility being a strength is that we ask ourselves, do people trust me? Do people trust me? Do they trust my words? Do they trust that I value them? Because Jesus was a humble leader, a competent leader, a leader who had authority, and a leader that people trusted. Mary Magdalene, Mary and Martha, all these faithful women who followed Jesus, took care of feeding them, of housing them. They trusted Jesus. Peter, James, and John left their jobs and followed Jesus for 3 years. Matthew was earning good money as a tax collector, left it and followed Jesus. Paul, well respected in his community, ends up going to prison for Jesus. He trusted him. He gave his life to him. All these disciples of Jesus trusted Jesus as the king sent from God. But the king who came to die on the cross, who came to give his life so that we could have. So when we compare Jesus to other kings in the New Testament, it's a pretty glaring difference. First, you have King Herod the Great. He was the ruler that we talk about at Christmas time. He was around when Jesus was born. And then after hearing that Jesus, the King of Israel, the Messiah, was come, he freaks out because his power is threatened. and he orders all children 2 and under to be slaughtered. Then his son comes along, and he's the one who orders John to be killed, to be beheaded. And then the grandson of Herod the Great comes along and persecutes the church and throws Peter in prison and kills James, the brother of John, one of the apostles. So these are the types of kings in the New Testament. So Jesus is set so different from these earthly kings who hold on to power, who are threatened by others' ideas, who are threatened by change. Jesus comes and says, come to me, and I will give you rest. I am gentle, humble in heart. He was a servant leader. And interesting enough, when you're in seminary and you go through courses, even as long ago as I did it, servant leadership is all everywhere. People talk about following Jesus, you're a servant leader. But now you see it all over the business world. Harvard Business Review had an article called How Humble Leadership Really Works, written by a guy named Dan Cable, who teaches in the London Business School in England. And he talks about servant leadership. He says this is one of the most important things a leader or an employer can do, is go to the people they work with and say, how can I help you do your job better? He said those are the most effective 21st century leaders, the ones who go to the people they work with. How can I help you do your job? Then the leader has to listen and listen to the workers, because oftentimes workers, and you know this, I've never owned my business, many of you already run, you know this, many of the workers, they know how to do their job. And so we listen to them and learn from them. As a pastor, again, right from the beginning of meeting with the search committee, I said, like, I don't know parole. I don't know anyone here. Who am I to come in and say, you know, here, this is how you do church, right? But listening, but trying to learn. Sometimes speaking too much, and sometimes you make mistakes. But in the end, this is your church. And so together, we listen and learn from each other and use all of our gifts and all of our strengths. To live as Christians, to serve in the Church of Jesus Christ, we need to take the time to listen to all voices and put into practice the best practices, so our church continues to be strong. I just read recently that the country singer and songwriter Mac Davis died last year. I told you we'd get to him. I didn't know this, but Mac Davis, he wrote a lot of hit songs for other people, including Elvis. But he may be best known for a song called It's Hard to Be Humble. It's a silly little song with words, if I remember, something about being perfect every day, being perfect in every way, getting better looking each day, and I think something about skin-tight blue jeans, but anyway. It's just a silly song. And yet, interesting, the title of the song is very true. It's hard to be humble. It's hard to be humble. To gain the strength that comes from humility is hard work. To be self-aware, to value others, and to be willing to have others teach us, that's hard work. And this is why Jesus comes to our life. This is why we need Jesus, to change us, make us the person he wants us to be. This is why Jesus comes and invites us. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened. Learn from me, and you will find rest for your souls. Amen.
Son of God, Son of God.
may he who is the blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and Lord of lords, rule in our hearts and minds and give us his peace.